Anyway, she, I stopped her dead in her tracks. She stopped around, turned around, she said, "What did you say?" I figured, I've impressed her now. So I blurted out my Merry Christmas again. But this time, I got a little nervous because I realized there's an awful lot of syllables in this Merry Christmas, like Merry Christmas, Joyeux Noël. This one had quite a few more. So she said, "One more time." Now I knew that I was probably in trouble. So I blurted out my Merry Christmas one more time. And then she said, "What are you trying to say?" I said, "I'm saying Merry Christmas." She says, "No, you're telling me I look lovely in my rubber boots."
Friend for life.
I thought that might be a fitting way to start because really we could be made to believe that we were doing one thing when actually accomplishing something else. And actually we can be unwittingly used of the enemy to do something we would consider wrong if we understood. Now, in this case, it was pretty harmless. I mean, you know, I mean, if she'd asked me if I wanted to tell her that, I would have said no. But it could have been a lot worse. Thankfully, she was kind to me enough. So anyways, we want to talk about these kinds of things today. And I also want to point out that this is a summary of Léo's blog, which has been going on since September, our third year of that. You can find the full-blown version at www.ca or at leogaumont.com. I've entitled the session, "Where Are We Going?" There's lots of things that may appear to be good, but in reality, they're not. And I want to share my thoughts on where I think home education is headed. Been at this for a very, very long time. As I said, I've been 40 years in education. I spent 25 years in the school. And we've been home educating. Well, we're so old, we've been disqualified from it here because we're not home educating. All of our children are, but we aren't. So, and I also need to point out to you, and it shouldn't come as a surprise, that I'll be approaching this from a Christian perspective without apology, for I find people who do not agree with me don't apologize to me. So the next thing we want to ask is, did you know, and these are just basic things that we should all be aware of, and that is that people willfully sin or error if they think they can get away with it. Matter of fact, each and every one of us probably all of a sudden got convicted there because we're all prone to that. We're human beings. We make mistakes. And the modern approach, and I don't agree with this, but the modern approach of dealing with sin and error is to pretend it did not happen. But when we do that, we actually validate and encourage yet more sin and error. And I think you also understand that our problems don't go away because we refuse to talk about them or to do something about them. So before we actually get started with the actual topic, we need to start off with a few foundational principles. Now, one of them is, this one I like it, is called, from Colossians 2:8, "Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ." You'll probably notice there's a choice. We have a choice. And really, it says we cannot serve two masters, we can only serve one. And we can choose the eternal God of creation, or we can choose to not serve the eternal God of creation. And so that will give us, well actually, maybe you've noticed that we live in a rather misguided world today, where deceit, deception, and perversion are becoming rather commonplace. The main objective, of course, of this is to destroy the faith in God. And the trick is to advance anything but the truth. You got to remember that if you're the enemy of God, God is the ultimate truth, then you will try to present something other than that. And the main assault is actually found on Christian religion and family. I hope you've noticed that publicly.
Yes.
Now, that gives us a binary, not a relative worldview. What I mean by that is very simple. It's either heaven or it's hell. There's nothing in between. It's right or it's wrong. There's nothing in between. It's good or it's evil. There's nothing in between. And contrary to modern day ideology, it's male or female. There's nothing in between. So then we need to talk about a very, very simple little formula that we need to understand is critically important to God. And it's important to us too. And it's simply that it takes a father and a mother to create a child. There is no possible combination otherwise. Matter of fact, it was made that way. And that's what separates life from non-life. Here's your biology lesson. This totem cannot reproduce itself. But life can. God is the God of life. The other God is going to have to be the opposite. He's the God of death. And death came in because of him. So we need to understand that only a father and a mother can create children. Governments can't, schools can't, churches can't, nothing can. Just moms and dad. That's it. Simple formula. We should be able to remember that. You'll also notice that I've got the father in all caps, and there's a good reason for that. I truly believe, and I've been studying this for quite some time, but I truly believe that the father is the greatest authority on earth. There is no greater authority than the Father. I'm going to repeat that just so you can understand what I believe. I believe that there is no greater authority than the Father. I've got a couple of quick little things to tell you to back this up. First of all, we refer to our earthly Father in the same name as we refer to our heavenly Father. Now, I'm familiar with two languages, and it works in both languages, and you can try it in your own if you know another language other than English. You think it's an accident that we refer to the earthly Father with the same name as our heavenly Father? I don't think so. And the other one, too, is this kind of escapes us, but God created Adam, and he gave Adam all authority over the earth. He gave it to Adam. Now, I don't know if this has escaped your attention, but Adam predates government. He predates churches. He predates schools. He predates all institutions. So I truly believe that the Father has the greatest authority on earth. And so therefore, with the approach that I'm using, I got to let you know this, because this is where I'm coming from in this presentation. And also, I underlined children. Here, you want to destroy the world? Take them out. Take children out of this formula, or for that matter, just take any part of this formula. Take father out, plus mother, or equals, or children. Take any part of this out, and the world as we know it comes to an end. It ceases to exist. This is what it's about. And it's that simple. It's really that simple. It doesn't have to be complicated. So, as we water down the faith, we start to blur the line. And it's not so easy for us to have that binary vision anymore. And if you cheapen children, you're cheapening life itself. Now, we need to understand that we do have an enemy. We do. And you may not like what I actually have to say to you. And I'll be making some pretty strong statements that may appear as judgments, which some may find offensive. My intention is not to offend, but to inform. And I may be telling some bad stories that will surprise you. And this is not revenge, it's not malice, it's not sour grapes. But to expose some of the things that are threatening home education in this province today. And also, you need to understand that when I say something, it has to be, because of the time limitations, they're sweeping generalizations. If I say something bad about something, that doesn't mean that everything in that world is tarred with the same brush. Okay, so can we understand that? That I'm just going to be highlighting some points, and you can't just simply say, well, this is applicable to everything. Here's the enemy. We forget that. How many of you remember Keith Green? As a musician, I've got a few of you, all right. He had a song there that really, really rattled my cage one time, and he was singing in the first person as though he was the devil. And he was laughing, saying, I can do anything I want to do because nobody believes in me anymore. We have an enemy, folks. and if we don't know who he is and that he's alive and well and he wants to destroy us, he will. So that's the enemy. It's not the people that I'm going to be talking about, and I won't be using names, I'll try not to anyways. Not the organizations who are only pawns in this big game. And he's got some tools, and these are the tools that I hope to talk to you about today. First of all, it's secularization. It leads us to man, not to God. Remember, we have only two possibilities. We can either be serving the eternal God or the alternative. So rather than, you know, confusing, we'll just simply say we're going to serve God or we're going to serve man. Those are the two options that we have. And we're secularizing. The love of money is the root of all evil. Shouldn't be any surprises there. Ignorance lets us be used of others. That's an important point that we need to understand. And then apathy, which is even worse than ignorance, because ignorance is when you actually don't know. This is not calling names, this is just simply saying you're misinformed. But apathy is when you know and choose not to do anything. And when you do that, you let others get away with things that really should not be happening within our Christian or within our home education community. And of course, all of these lead to compromise. And I'm not sure if you've ever considered this, but as soon as you start to compromise, the first casualty is always the truth. And some simple little foundational questions. People say that I'm visionary. There's no trick to this. It's very simple. Where has this come from? That's the past. Where has it led us to? And where will it take us? So if you have some history, it brings you to this. You draw a little line, an arrow, and then you kind of look down the line and you can kind of more or less predict where this is going to take us. So that's what I've been doing. And of course, I always ask these three questions. Is it coming from or related to or leading to eternal or temporal purposes? Okay, now, we're finally getting on to the presentation now that we've got all the foundations built. We're going to talk about the history of home education, and I'm going to do like a 300-year survey in about 2 minutes. Are you ready? School starts during the Reformation. School as we know it. In the 1860s-ish, compulsory school starts in Prussia, which is around the same time as Darwin's origin of species. I'm not sure if there's any connection there, but it's kind of interesting. In the 1870s, a compulsory school was brought to North America, where children are marched off to school at gunpoint. The parents were not in favor of having their children taught by somebody else. They knew whose responsibility it was to educate them. But 50 years later, guess what? After doing it over and over and over again, we get so used to it, we're not only complying, but we're demanding home education. The compulsory education, and it is accepted as the norm. So now that we've got all the children in school, we can start to introduce some new techniques in teaching. But really, in the 1930s, way back then, that's almost 100 years ago, we started to introduce things into the school system which were designed to change society. The 1940s turned the world upside down during the World War, and by the 1950s, parents were abdicating their authority to professionals. And we've been doing it ever since. Once the 1960s showed up, the social revolution led to the secularization of the schools, and that brought about the private schools in the 1970s. And they were trying to escape the public school. They were trying to escape the secularization that was going on in the public school. And then by the 1980s, we're finding that the private schools had a few problems. In other words, they couldn't be everywhere. They weren't always affordable. And some of them actually just were another version of the school. So home education got its start. Because for one reason, that the parents did not want their children into the public system. Matter of fact, home education started with very dedicated, focused Christians wanting to escape secular programming and ideology in obedience to God's directive. They did it because they wanted to get away from that secularization in school, or they did not have a private school they could attend, or they couldn't afford the private school tuition in order for their children to attend. The three main reasons why that started. There's an interesting point I want to make here. When we started, and we were there, my wife and I in the beginning, in the 80s, when we started, there was a lot of persecution. We were persecuted as home educators. Have you noticed that we're not being persecuted today? I think that begs the question, why? Do you think it's because the world's come around to our way of thinking? Or do you think that we've started thinking like the world? Why are we not being persecuted? Wasn't that something that God promised us if we did the right thing? Just a thought. By the 1990s, money moves in. And boy, I was fighting it then. Those of you that know me know I've been duking it out forever. This is one of the first wars that I fought. And one of the first times I got into real trouble with the provincial organization, because they thought it was a good idea, and I'm saying, no, it's going to poison us. By the 2000s, money takes over. By then, we're involved in being a home education provider, not a school, a provider, Education Unlimited. And we're getting questions like, how much money are you getting? How much money are you providing? That's the first question. And I know that I got a little bit miserable sometimes. I just simply say, not enough, find somebody else. So by the 2010s, I've been watching this, and I think the original focus is mostly lost. The reason why we start with mostly lost is secularization of home education is so rapidly advancing that we can no longer tell the difference between home education and school. There's just a continuum, sort of all kinds of blending and things that take place, so that there really isn't a line anymore. Remember we said we can only serve one master? Remember we said that things actually tend to be good or evil, or one way or the other, that there is no in-between? Well, there is an in-between today in home education. Now, I'm just going to skip across some of the main sources contributing to the secularization of Christian home education today. And I'm going to start with the big boys, the government themselves. Now, we have to understand the government does have its place, but we need to know this very important thing. God allowed what he did not want because it was demanded. You can go to 1 Samuel and find out about that. And there's something we need to establish as well. God is God. Government is not. God has never given government authority over parents or children. Check it out. And if I'm wrong, please come and tell me. Before, I've really been trying to figure this mess out. He's never given it. So I can make this kind of a statement. The only reason why the government has any authority at all is because those that had the authority gave it to them. And so I can make a statement that probably will offend some. The government has no business in education. Now, when you look around at what's going on today, you can say, well, hold the phone. Aren't they calling the shots? Yes, sir. That doesn't change this statement. From a biblical perspective, government was never ever given authority over children or parents. They have no business in education. Next is the church. I have to be careful here because I always step on toes. You'll notice that the church, I forgot my C. That's not a misspelled, it's on purpose. I'm talking about the institutional church. I'm not talking about the body of Christ that cannot possibly be ill. We understand that? Okay? There's a difference here. And in the institutional church, for the most part, they've gone, to the government to obtain permission to exist. And because they've gone there, the government rewards this compliance with the continued ability to issue tax receipts. Once again, I want to remind you that I'm not throwing everybody here into the same pot, but I think this is a general statement that we can make. And if we consider this little simple thing like we are the slaves of whom we obey, or you don't bite the hand that feeds you, then we can ask a very legitimate question, which is, where is this leading us to? Remember, we can only serve one of two gods. As a consequence, you've probably noticed that in not so much today, but certainly in the beginning, when we were talking about the beginning of home education, do you know who was the main persecutor of home educating parents? You would find it hard to believe it was the church. And so because the church is likely to support and encourage a government usurpation of parental authority and to advance its education system as a Christian way to do that. I've been asked to speak in church on occasion, and unfortunately, they have asked me to speak about education. I have to tell you that I've never been invited back. You'll split the church right down the middle. You go to church and you start talking and saying that we have the responsibility and the authority to home educate. You're going to split the church down the middle, because a lot of them there believe that it's the government's job. Erroneously. And what we do too is, I love this one, I have to bring it up. I have a little note here that says, don't use this, and here I'm going to use it. Render unto Caesar. Check it out. We're talking taxes, folks, not children. So yeah, pay Caesar the taxes. Don't give him the children. Speaking of Caesar, have you ever considered the gigantic machine out there that was called the Roman Empire? Do you know how it came to an end? It rotted. It decayed from the inside. It wasn't the outside that took it down. It was the inside. The compromising. So, now, this one here, I can write a book on this one. After 25 years, I got lots of bad things to say here. But anyways, the school is such a fixed aspect of modern life that no one questions this or critically analyzes it. We just take it. As a matter of fact, even when we escape it, we copy it. We bring the grades home, we bring the subjects home, we bring the processes home. We just think that somehow that's the only way that we can train children. I don't get it, because as a public school, high school teacher, for all those years, I discovered something. I looked and searched and searched and looked, and there's two things I never ever found. I never found that standard student. And I know this may come as a bit of a shock to you, but I also never found the perfect family. Because they don't exist. We're just people. Now, it may have started off right, but it no longer is so. And school cannot be fixed or reformed. You can't do it. There is no parental control. The most control I ever saw parents having over schools, and I've been in public school, separate school, private school, in two provinces and two languages, maybe the parents might have the authority to be able to decide whether or not they should have hot dogs at the field day. And from being on the inside and seeing the staff meetings, the parents who were sincere and going out there and trying to change the school were mocked and laughed at during the staff meeting. Hurt me. So modern public schools essentially have become secular socialist churches, where the adherents are being equipped to destroy the Christian faith and family. Remember that the church themselves has apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers, but the equipping of the saints as well for the work of the ministry. This is the opposite. Now, a school is a school is a school is a school. So if you've got a public school, well, it's a public school, and a separate school is a public school with a few other things that make it separate. A private school, for all intents and purposes, is also a public school. For the most part, the vast majority of them are using secular programming. You see, without government funding, private schools could barely survive. So most take the government funding along with all the strings that are attached. You know, he who pays the piper simply calls a tune, including government programming. And I really hate to say this, but there's an awful lot of stuff that I think there's probably in this province, maybe, there might be five. I don't know of five, but I'm just being careful. There might be five schools that actually are using Christian programming, period. Most of them actually either use public programming or they use a variation thereof. They use a public programming and then they take Christian materials to meet the public program. Okay? Now, I don't mean to be offensive here, and this is hard for me to do, but you can't lead people to one faith by using the book of another. In other words, it would be silly for us to think that we can lead people to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ by using the Quran or some other book. There's a book that's actually designed for leading people to Christianity. It's called the Bible. So if we normalize and we Christianize a secular humanistic process, we really have nothing more than a Christianized version of government programming. I know that maybe it sounds silly, but you know, and I'm just throwing this out, are Christian lies better than lies? Is Christian adultery better than adultery? If you know what I'm saying? Just because we attach a Christian moniker to it does not fix it. And so sometimes what we're doing, and I've seen this before in private schools, is we use public programming, but we clean it up of all of its stuff. We take everything, all the relations to evolution and all the references to feminism and environmentalism, and it goes on and on and on and on and on. The list was very, very lengthy. But there isn't a human being capable of doing that. There isn't a teacher. I know I'm a teacher. There's no time to do that. Essentially, what we're doing is we're fooling parents into thinking that we can offer fresh water from a pail of sewage. That public programming. How adamant am I about that? Need I remind you that for 25 years, I was spending my day actually helping people using public programming? And need I remind you that my children were not subjected to that stuff? That's not good stuff. And we shouldn't try to Christianize it or normalize it. Matter of fact, the whole idea of public programming has actually led some schools to just simply disappear. We're doing the public programming, we're having to hire the teacher, you know, the government's teacher, and we're only getting 70%. Why not just join the local public school as an alternative? Now, here's what I never understood. Every time this has happened, and I've actually seen quite a few of them happen, and a few of them I was in a place where I could advise. It wasn't solicited. I just told them what I thought. And, you know, they all say the same thing. They say, well, the public system has promised us that we're still going to have all the choices and all the autonomy and all the authority within the school. And the public system has also promised us that we're going to be able to hire all our own teachers, and we're going to be able to approach everything from a Christian perspective. La-di-da-di-da-di-da-di-da. Well, a few years later, I'll ask you, and they go, well, it didn't turn out the way we thought. Folks, when you make a pact with the devil, don't be shocked when you discover he's lying to you. So we've lost a lot of our private schools. A lot of them are gone. They're just disappeared. And we had a lot of experience this year, and again, speaking in generalities, we ended up in a lot of private schools this year. We really did. If you don't know what happened, we actually ended up getting booted out of our 16-year relationship with a school. And a lot of people who were registered through us didn't even know that they basically had been essentially taken over by another organization. It's pretty ugly stuff. It shouldn't happen, but it did. And as we went out there, there was a threat. I found that the vast majority of the private Christian schools, because they were indeed getting help from the government, had a far greater fear of government than they had faith in God. And we found ourselves, and I hate to say this, but we were lied to, we were manipulated, there were hostile takeover attempts. We can go on and talk about all the stuff that you would expect in the world. It was there. Broke our hearts. So the home educator should be aware that the private school that they're registered with is motivated. If it's motivated by anything other than pleasing God, this is the separation. Then it will direct them towards man's system and away from God. That's a simple thing that we need to understand. Home education providers, we have in this province such a warped system because of the funding. It ends up creating a whole new world. We've got home education providers. So we can register either with a public school, a separate school, a private school, or with one of the ICHESs. That's almost hard to say. That's an independent contracted home education specialist. This would not exist outside of the province of Alberta if it were not for the funding. Understand that. This is basically a monster created from the funding. And another thing you need to consider is if it weren't for the funding, there wouldn't be no such thing as a facilitator. Because it's all based on the money. Now, schools receive money for students registered, so much marketing for clients takes place. And there's another little formula you need to understand is the more public program you can offer, or if you will, shove down people's throats, the more money you'll get paid. So you can see how we can start blurring the lines by waving that dollar around. Incidentally, you ever consider this? When you are serving God, you have an eternal vision. But if you're serving anything else, as in money, your vision is impeded by the fact that you're focused on something else. It's a pretty simple little thing. Now, financial incentives lead to questionable activities. Many providers and such activities is a very bad testimony for the Christian community. I'm probably going to talk real fast here. How about this? An organization actually goes to Google, buys ads so that as soon as you put in a name, it's actually redirected to their site. Is that good or is that bad? How about one that basically leaves one school, takes all the students and all the staff to another school, and that school dumps them and takes them to yet another school? Does this make sense? Are you following here what I'm saying? Then, of course, there's always this idea of one school or a home education provider actually sold to another person who actually isn't even living in Canada at the time, and for several years runs a system from the States, and then what happens is that he sells yet another educational agency and then gets involved with a school that's already involved with another agency, and yuck. How can that happen? And you know what bothers me? It's done in the name of Christianity. It shouldn't be, but it's happening. There's some pretty bad stuff that's going on. There really is. And I've been watching it. I see it. You don't. And it's because of position I'm in, that I can see what's going on. Facilitator. Okay, I want to stop beating up for a minute. If there be no facilitators, there was no funding. And you need to understand that sometimes that's the only source that we have. I would think that the vast majority of people think that they're registered with their facilitator. They're not. They're also not registered with the home education provider. Here in AHIA, they call them boards. They're sitting in the exhibit hall. There's only one that's legitimately a board. The rest of them are pretenders. They're not. We call them ICHESs. But they're not school boards. You're not registered with them. You can't. Any more than you can register with this computer. You need to register with the school. Parents do not answer to the facilitator. That's important to understand. And they should never override the authority of the parents. They should be their servants. And they can sincerely be wrong. There are facilitators out there who have done nothing more than teach for their whole lives, and when they finally get to retire, they decide that they're going to go out there and show the rest of the world how to what? Play school. That's all they know. They're sincere. They're wonderful. Well worth the coffee, tea, and cookies that you give to facilitators. Much appreciated. But in the end, they're not really actually doing them any good. Because all, you know what, if you're going to be leading, we need to ask, and where are you leading at? Home education organizations themselves, another one. This is one example. We have support groups that have become sectarian. Have you noticed that? I mean, our local support group is actually run by one ICHIS. There's another one up north that's run by a Catholic school. There's another one that's run by yet another ICHIS in another area. I mean, and what happens is it becomes so sectarian is that if you don't belong to that particular ICHIS or school or whatever, well, then you're really not welcome. Well, that's fine Christian fellowship. That worked just great. Organizations all the same. They start off with good reasons and good intentions. We were here when AHIA was started, just a few years later. Actually, we were here in the beginning, because that's how I got into trouble. I sat on the board for a number of years. I know what her heart was like, and I'm taking a look today, and I'm shaking my head, and I'm going, what's happened? We lose our reason and purpose. It takes one generation, or it takes maybe just the fact that the founders leave. And over time, these organizations can lose their focus to the point where their own survival becomes their chief purpose. And the other thing I don't like about these organizations, as I mentioned, is that they can actually be influenced by one organization. So essentially, it becomes just one version of something. Well, that was them. That's the agencies that are outside. Remember we talked about Rome? Those are the agencies that are coming from outside that are attacking home education in this province. And they're directly or indirectly associated with home education. And I want to say that they're not necessarily all bad. We need to understand that. But we also just don't want to turn a blind eye to the fact that there are some things that are going on that shouldn't. So we need to understand this very, very important thing. I don't know how much I have to emphasize on this. Just in case you're not quite sure, I'll increase it for you. I spent 40 years of my life in education. When I started teaching, I was nuts. I actually thought I was working for the parents. Got me into knowing the trouble with my administration over and over and over again. But I can say in 40 years of experience in the school, I had 3 disagreements with parents. 3. And in every case, they became my friends. Somehow, even before I was a believer, I understood that parents are actually the only ones that could create children. And that the ones who could create children should actually be the ones who are actually in authority and have the responsibility. And so I worked for them. Remember I talk about accumulated enemies? I've accumulated lots on that one. It hurt me to see the children bought and sold, like I just talked about, different home education providers, selling businesses, selling schools, moving things about. Like commodity, like they're buying and selling wheat. We're actually working with the authority of the moms and dads and buying and selling children. If that doesn't split your heart in half, it certainly splits mine. It's about the children. It's about the children. A few years ago, we had a big meeting over here regarding the new Education Act, and all the ICHESs and providers were invited to a room upstairs. And we sat down and everybody pontificated for I don't know how long, and I just couldn't believe what I was hearing. Finally, somebody said I'd be interested in hearing what Léo has to say, and I got a few more enemies when I said this. Have you noticed we've been here now for the last 20 minutes and there's not a single person who has even mentioned family or children? See, we're losing it. There's a thread that goes through the system. Man desires power and control to be godlike, and he uses money and fear and guilt and whatever else to buy or otherwise overcome the father's authority in order to get to the children. They are a currency that fuels the system. Your children are worth $1,680.70, right? Close? Something like that.
70 and 81.
That's what they are. When you went to school, you weren't even a human being. You were a number. I knew that. When I was in school, I would have these great big classes in high school, in grade 12 biology, and there would be 37 children in there, but there's only 28 in the class. What's going on? Well, then it got to be maybe 30. But then on October the 1st, suddenly my class size changed. I wonder why. Folks, it hurts me, but it's about the money. Okay, what about home education? I got to take this home, they say. That was then. What about us? We can't keep blaming others. We must be responsible here too. Home educators, for the most part, are casualties of the system. You've been to school, that's all you've ever seen. I'm not calling names, and I'm not actually degrading anybody here. I'm saying that's all you know. If you've never seen any other vehicle other than a Chevrolet, guess what you're going to buy? That's just the way it is. That's all we're exposed to, that's all we know, and we bring that stuff home. Knowing nothing else, we advance it, we normalize it, we standardize it. And organizations out there that are marketing for your money, I'm sorry, students, are going to be doing just that. They're going to find out where your weakness is. If you're a good salesman, what do? You try to solve a problem. And so here, we are affected way too much by the money. Way too much. It kind of hurt me yesterday. I had somebody who hasn't been in this conference for quite some time and showed up and he said, man, he said, that's a real trade fair. Trade fair. I thought it was about home education. What are we training in, anyways, in this trade fair? God gives parents the sole authority for raising. And I want to go back to that second point. Affected way too much by money. I have seen the worst behavior possible. We hate the month of May. We call it Money May. We have been dumped like garbage, just shoved aside for $25. Gone from one provider to another because the one provider said, sure, we'll buy you your $400 remote control toy. Somebody else coming along saying, we won't use computers. No. Marketing. I'm not sure if you understand the difference, but there's a big difference between marketing and ministry. When we're marketing, we're doing what we can, using people to help ourselves. Ministry is what Jesus asked us to do, which is to lay our own lives down for others. You can't have both. You can only have one. You can have ministry and then market the ministry, but if you're starting off with marketing, ministry's gone. The third point, God gives parents the sole authority for raising and educating their children, but they're quick to advocate to this professional. We really do. And are the home education providers taking care of that? Sure, we'll take care of your English course. We'll take care of your geography course. Who said you had to make a Bible just out of your son? But we're preying on the weaknesses. And we're not usually prepared to defend home education. And I had an older fellow come along and said, you know, we need you old guys. He called me a guy, he could call me something else that goes with old. But anyway, he actually said, we need you old guys. He says, because you guys know what it's like to fight. He says, by the time we showed up, he said, the fight was over. Well, it looked like the fight was over. It's just that we kept fighting and we were fighting for you. Well, I don't know if you've noticed, we're getting a little gray-haired, a little tired, and my start is getting a little dull. You need to take some of this on. So what's the consequence of socialization? I got to go a little quicker here. The church is compromised, and therefore is in trouble. And that because it's compromised, the church is in, or the Christianity is in trouble as well. Private Christian schools are really in trouble. Home education providers are as well. Home education organizations focused on money and doing what is needed to survive are in trouble. Have you noticed that the last time we talked to the Minister of Education, one of the big things we were saying is that we want the ECHESIS? Once again, I asked this question, what's this got to do with children? Because of that, I believe that home education is in trouble. And money? You start viewing children as currency, you've lost my fellowship. I'm sorry, I hit the button twice. Agencies are willing to exploit parents. I see it. My wife said there's nothing that makes me grouchier, more unhappy, more discouraged than coming to this place. I walk into that exhibit hall and I see what's going on and it just goes, oh man, how could we be doing that? And you know what, this might be a little hard, but parents are willing to sell the children to the highest bidder. We've seen it over and over and over again. Parents that will leave us and go to somebody else, they're offering $25 a kid more. And we're talking about relationships that we had for a dozen years. And all of a sudden they're gone. For $25, somebody marketing offered $25. Or blended programming will give you even more money. It's sad. You know what? Because of the money, I think home education is in trouble. What about the consequences of ignorance? Well, if you don't know, you can be taken advantage of. You really can. You know, they say ignorance is bliss. Not true. Don't believe that. People will not be moved to action when they're unaware, unless you know that their people are actually, if you read my blogs, you know, I'd like to say preying on parents there, but that's not true. Because if you understand here my biology again, the predator-prey relationship, the predator kills the prey. This isn't a form of predation. It's actually closely related to parasitism, where the parasite has to latch on to someone and become a host. You can't harm that host, because when you harm the host, you harm yourself. And that's what's going on, and it's all hooked up by money. Loss of control without knowing it. That's what happens when you're ignorant. And I'm not saying ignorant in a bad way, just ill-informed or misinformed. And as a consequence, I believe that home education is in trouble. What about apathy? Well, let's go to the Bible. It's sin. I don't know what else to talk or how else to describe it. Therefore, to him who knows to do good does not, to him it is sin. If you know that this stuff is going on, if you knew, as an example, what transpired last year in the great exchange of private schools and ECHESIS, and just continued on with the people that perpetrated this, that's called apathy. And if you knew that that shouldn't have happened, then you shouldn't have been part of it. Because if you don't do something about it, you become complicit in the crime. The validation of false claims, tons of it. We become apathetic and all of a sudden we start believing junk like you need high school credits to go to post-secondary students. And not only that, we allow those people, the very people that orchestrated the worst thing ever to happen in home education in this province, are sitting in the exhibit hall today looking for more clients. Should they be there? I think home education is in trouble. This next one is a little bit graphic, excuse me. But what exactly is killing home education? So I decided to, and I was thinking about this, I figured killing him, you know, all this stuff. So I figured, okay, well, I'll just get a silhouette of a man, and I'll say that ignorance is actually very, very much what's killing home education today. And for those people who know and do nothing, then apathy is the next thing that's killing home education. And if that doesn't do it, the compromising will. But if you really want to know what's killing home education today, it's the very, very same thing that's killing Christianity today. It's the very same thing that's killing families today. It's the very same thing that is killing all things good, and that is secularization. And if the secularization doesn't do it, I'll guarantee you, the money will. That's where we're at today. Ouch. You know, when you stop and consider it, there are people out here who really believe in government. They believe in church. They believe in schools of all kinds. They believe in home education providers and agencies, organizations, facilitators. But I'm going to repeat what Jesus said. When I return, will I find faith on earth? We believe in all these things, but we have virtually no faith in God. Somehow we think that it's our responsibility. We seriously need to escape this money, and that'll only happen if we have options to do so. And that'll only happen if we have the option to notify. Now understand, if we actually get into notification, the ones that are going to fight this the hardest is not the parents, but all the agencies that we talk about that could do nothing but benefit from the money. Understand that. These are supposedly our friends, but if they're given a choice between putting a gun to their own heads or putting it to yours, guess where they're going to put it? If we're going to do anything regarding notification in this province, you're going to have to do it as a home educator, because I do not believe for a minute any of the agencies that we've talked about are going to be on our team. They need your kids, their money. Okay, where are we going? Well, before we discuss where we're going, let's just review our job description. As parents, he's asked us to train and teach our children, not to provide a future. Please read this. He's asked us to train and teach our children, not to provide a future. What do you know about the future? Nothing. That's God's business. The world that does not know God thinks that we have to somehow prepare these blank evolutionary cosmic freak wonders to be some kind of a, you know, a cog in the wheel, you know, to be able to survive in society and so on. We've got to create something of the children because, after all, they were not created. But we're coming from the perspective that God indeed did create them. And not only did he say they were good, if you read it, what did he say when he created them? They were very good. So they've already been created. And he's got a purpose and a place in the future. When we start putting faith in God, cruise control. That doesn't absolve us of responsibility. Of course we have to work. Of course we have to train them. But do we have to shove algebra down their throats? If it works for them, that's good. But if it doesn't, why are we trying to create an algebra mathematician out of somebody that God never created an algebra mathematician out of in the first place? You can't make me into a mechanic. Okay? I'm hurting today because I tried that. I can teach. I'll hire a mechanic to do the work for me. We can't be everything. We train the mind without neglecting the heart. Bodie Blockham was here a few years ago. Oh, I really enjoyed that guy. Actually, somebody said I was a northern Bodie Blockham. When I took a look at him, I went, no way. He was big, good-looking guy in here, and a little rut, small. We were different colors, too. It doesn't matter. But he was saying that we're missing it because what we're doing is we're actually training children to be part of system. We're trying to outdo the school. Well, that's not our point. Our point is not to outdo the school, it's to lead them to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ and to get them to perpetuate that. The only thing we're ever going to take to heaven are the people that we've been instrumental in leading to a saving knowledge of Christ. That's it. So, you know, the head is okay, but let's work on the heart as well. And are we vigilant in protecting ourselves and our futures? You want to hear something? Former principal that I was working with didn't get along too well with him, and he actually tried desperately to orchestrate the killing of Thayani and the destruction of Education Unlimited and the stealing of the students. Not sure if you ever noticed, but kill, steal, and destroy is actually not part of God's job description. But anyways, aside from that, he was out there and we were looking at things that were being done at the provincial level, and I'm saying, this is going to be very, very harmful for home education and for private education. His response, I don't care. It doesn't bother me. I'm retiring in a couple of years. That's a leader for you. How about this other one? He says, no, I don't want to actually help you out because I'm retiring as well, and I don't want to be burdened with any extra work. There's compassion. There's love. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another. Do we have that love? And that's just not talking people to people. I think if Christians are going to start making organizations, I would hope that their organizations would reflect their character. Okay, you ready for the bad news? If you haven't already had a whole bunch. How about some more bad news? I'll tell you what, if you walk with me through the bad news, and if you're good, I might just give you some good news to end with, all right? Unless we get serious about being informed of what is happening, don't stick your head in the sand. If it's ugly, look at it. Find out why. Where did it come from? How is it affecting us today? And where will this garbage lead us? Unless we start actively defending our authority. Folks, I have stood before the Department of Education dozens and dozens of times. And I know that while we were with our last school, we never lost a single battle. And it's not that I'm some kind of super duper, well, I might be ugly, but anyway, there's something that scares them. But what is it? I'm standing in the authority that God has given me. And it's a greater authority than anything else on earth. Understand that. That's what just makes me, you know, brave. It's that God's bigger than the little guy. Then while we avoid the secularization of education and resisting the lure of money, this sounds nuts. We've been working with home education for 20 years, 25 years, and we've made our living for it. And for all that time, I've been fighting the funding. If you understand what I'm saying, is I'm actually been trying to destroy my livelihood. That's how important it is to me. Christian home education is doomed to be absorbed in a secular socialist vortex that's leading us away from God and right back to the bondage that we were trying to escape. That's what the future looks like to me. And I'm a little closer to the future than you are, actually, just my age, I guess. Okay, you've been good. So it's not all bad news. There are many home educators committed to following God rather than man. Seriously, we know a lot of them, and you're here. It's really a privilege to be able to work with people who are dead serious about serving God with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength. And there's lots of you. That's the good news. We're not done yet. And there are still some agencies out there that care and are committed to advancing the kingdom of God. The question that I ask is, check these agencies out and ask yourself a question. What would happen if the funding stopped? Would they still have that love for home education? Actually, let's ask this question. If there was no funding for home education in the province of Alberta, how many organizations sitting at an exhibit hall right there, right now, today, would be there tomorrow wanting to help you out? And these are legitimate questions that we should ask. I'm not trying to be a jerk here, although I can be. I've had lots of years of practice. But really, it's about having, you know, just looking reality in the face. And if we determine to defend our authority and restore our Christian values within the home education community, we have hope for the next generation. Let's go back to our formula. Fathers plus mothers equals children. That's our future. That's our life. We're all going to get planted one day. How do we live on? Through our children. Let's give them the hope that they need. And the one, of course, that's even bigger than that is if we redeem and restore our Christian values within the home education community, we will have hope, the eternal hope that is in Christ. Let's not lose sight. It's very simple. I did not say easy. I said it is simple. And we just need to abide by that. So, I got some stuff I didn't even know I had. Maybe I don't have to do this. Let me just check. I think I'm over time by 2 minutes and 47 seconds. Okay, I'll go through this. Let's remove secular thinking and teaching from Christian education. Let's give some serious consideration to the place of money in our lives. Let's demand quality leadership, intent on advancing and defending the authority of parents and home education, not the bottom line. I got a few minutes, not many, I'm already over time. This particular organization actually wrote a letter to the Department of Education. Did you know that? And in that letter it said, we're willing to actually meet you halfway. The Department of Education, I don't think they even said anything about testing kids, but somebody influencing this organization actually already wrote to the Department of Education and said, oh, well, I'll tell you what, if we have to test them, we can do it this way. Did you know that? Did you know that there's somebody out there that's actually willing to barter away a little bit of your authority so that some ICHIS or home education provider or something can continue to exist? I mean, this is ugly stuff, but if we demand leadership, and leading people to do what everybody else is doing is not leadership. I hope you understand that. Leadership is actually leading in a different direction, not in that way. And be prepared to vote with our feet. It's time that we start saying, look, what you did there was wrong, and I know that I like this and so on, and you've been good to us, but you know, I can't condone that. I've got to move on. Go to the annual general meeting. Make your voice heard, like John Carpe was saying. You know, are you fearful? You know, are you discouraged? You shouldn't be. We're working for the eternal God. He's got it all. Oh, I'm going to end by waxing poetic. I bet you didn't know I had that gift, did you? Well, actually not. I started off by stealing something called United We Stand, Divided We Fall. And then I added some words, an and an if, which incidentally are two of the most important words in the Bible. And then I added, if we don't stand up and be counted, we won't count at all. We do indeed stand up and start making some noise. I got just a very short time here. I can actually get a vote from the people. If we can go over a couple of minutes, that all right? I want to introduce a few people that are in the crowd today. I want to actually acknowledge people that have actually been standing along with me, some for a very long time, some for a short time. But we have Ted Tedderoff, who's been standing for home education in this province for a long time. Dr. Michael Wagner has been defending just Christianity for a long time. We have Gary Weens, who's actually been got such a heart for the future of families, realizing to take families out of the formula that's gone. We have Brian Colwell, who is he's been the biggest voice defending home education and private schools from the Bill Kim. He wasn't prepared for this because most servants aren't looking for accolades, I can say that. But I do want to publicly say that he has done a lot, very, very much for Christian education in this province. Thank you very much, Brian. Now, I don't know if I've missed anyone. John, are you here? John said he might come. But, of course, John Carpe has been very, very much a part of that as well. I don't want to miss anybody. So what I want to do is simply say, you can all stand up. Because the fact that you came here today means that maybe, just maybe, you're part of this too. And maybe you could be one of those warriors. So why don't you do that? Stand up. Because you know what? The world can only win if we let it. Are we going to let it? No. I see an army here. Folks, and you've got the creator of heaven and earth sitting on your team. You've got nothing to fear. Thank you. Thank you very much. God bless. I scared a few, but if you've got any questions, I do have about 2 minutes and 36 seconds before the time is up. Yes? Okay, the definition of notification is that you go to the government and you say, dear Mr. Government, we're going to home educate. We don't want your money. We don't want your facilitators. We don't want your control. We don't want your anything. We will do it on our own. We will take responsibility for the education of our children. I think that all the provinces in Canada have that. As a matter of fact, New Brunswick, I love New Brunswick. It's a letter to the minister, dear minister, get lost, end of story. Okay, it's that simple. And then they're left alone. Now, the government thinks that they have the responsibility for the education, or the authority and responsibility for the education of the children, which you already know is not theirs at all. So they passed laws that simply said that everybody has to be educating. So in every province in Canada, you have to do something to let them know that their children are actually being educated. So notification is simply saying, we're taking that responsibility, thank you very much, goodbye. And that's what we're advocating. We're advocating notification for the simple reason that you don't get snarled up in the money, and we don't get the competition that we have here for the souls of those children. Yes.
Has that been available for a long time, the letter of notification?
Notification has not actually ever been available in Alberta. It's something that we're looking to take care of. We want to advance it. Now, what you can do, and this one is a hard one, what you can do is you can actually register with a school, an ICIS or whatever, and you can refuse the funding. Now, that gives you some control, because essentially, if you've refused the funding, you also have the ability to say, well, since I'm not taking any money, I won't have any of your strengths, so I don't want to see your facilitator. Then, of course, if that's us, you still want to see me. But anyway, that's another story. But what I'm saying is that you can, but be careful. This is where the private Christian schools and, well, all the schools have a bit of an issue. They would like to encourage you not to use the funds, because any money you don't use, they get. Okay? So you need to understand that if I am going to start to really make a lot of noise about notification, I'm expecting the greatest amount of opposition from the very institutions that we're registered with today. Because if you do that, you're taking away the money. And it's a sad story, but that's where it's at. That's what it is. Another question? Yes, sir.
What is your justification, or at least your viewpoint, in the sense that we pay tax, we are paying for the public school system, whether we like it or not, whether we're involved in it or not, and how to not accept any sort of funding, that money is still, we pay for it.
Okay, the question, I'm supposed to be repeating these questions, is, you know, how do we answer the fact that we're paying taxes and we're getting nothing out of it, is really what you're saying. Well, a couple of things I need to say about that. First of all, I'm all for tax rebates. I love tax rebates. I do. I think that's a great thing. But I don't think tax rebates at any cost. Now, if you don't mind, I'm going to make a statement here. And the question is, whose money is it? If it's my money, I want to get a rebate. If it's God's money, it doesn't matter. And so if we're talking about making a choice between whether or not we should be getting a rebate and all the strings attached that actually dethrones us as the king of our house, or otherwise, we need to question that. So that's my opinion on that. Yes, Mr. Bryan.
Do you understand also that some private Christian school boards are non-profit organizations, registered charities, they're not in it for the money? I get zero salary, I volunteer in my position. But the issue is not money, it's covetousness and the love of money. And if you're going to let money corrupt you and sell out your parental rights and your parental authority, that's the danger zone. But Leo, I must say, there's no such thing as free education.
Right.
At some point, there has to be a bottom line to...
It's going to cost somebody something, yeah. And again, I want to reiterate the fact that I said I'm not painting everybody and everything with the same brush. You've got to remember I had exactly 50 minutes to put this whole thing together, so I didn't have time to explain that. But as I did say in the good news, and not everybody is motivated that way, we need to be able to distinguish between the one and the other. Thank you, Brian.